Archbishop Desmond Tutu once called Dr. Paul Farmer, quote, one of the great advocates for the poorest and the sickest of our planet. So I'm really honored today to be joined by Dr. Farmer. So thank you for coming.
Thank you.
Let's start to talk a bit about your background and where you've come from. You and your family of, I think, eight moved around a lot when you were a kid. And I think you might have actually maybe even lived on a houseboat, if that's true, in Florida.
Houseboat.
A houseboat. And there
sounds
was a
good, but
yeah, school bus. Can you talk a bit about where you came from and how that might have shaped some of your feelings about health and medicine?
You know, one thing when you said moving around a lot is, you know, I later came to realize that we actually had a very stable childhood, mm-hmm. very, you know, an intact family, two parents who thought it was a good idea to go to college. You know, they didn't pester, I mean, they didn't say you should go here or there. It would be great to go to college. Most people don't get to. So anyway, it sounds strange living in a bus. And just to give
an example. Was it really a bus or was it a boat?
It was a bus and then a boat. But just to give an example of what one could do if you were given to exaggerating causality, I could say, well, you know, I lived in a bus for many years with eight people, and it was a bus that was used to screen people for tuberculosis. That's true. But
is that
again,
where you got the love of medicine?
Was it? Well, but see, if I say that, then what about, why didn't my brother get it? He got a love of wrestling and pro football. I mean, all I know is, you know, I have a deep debt to my parents for, you know, love of learning, thinking about other people who might have worse problems than you do. So we knew, and my parents made sure we knew that we were not unfortunate at all, and that we had lots to be thankful for. And that's a great gift. Great gift.
Where did Haiti fit in? Because you found out you got into Harvard Medical School while you were in Haiti.
I was in Haiti, yeah.
And then you met Jim Yong Kim in 87 in Haiti?
I met him actually when I went to interview at Harvard Medical School in 1983, but we became good friends in later. But I met Ophelia Dahl in Haiti in 1983, and I met Tom White on that same fateful interview trip to Boston, and he later became our chief supporter. So,
and then Jim went on to be obviously president of the World Bank. You know, when you guys thought about founding Partners in Health, what was the primary mission that you were thinking about in 1987 at the time? What was the most topical issue?
I think that's where we actually got something right for the first time. You know, opening up a clinic that is sure to fail is not, just remember that it's a, you know, other people paid the price for your learning, you know, mediocre services. Just because they were better than the other services in the town doesn't mean they were acceptable. Because I shouldn't have been comparing one part of a town in central Haiti to another, but rather Harvard and Haiti. That's what I should have mm-hmm. been doing. That became the primary tension in my life, which is a good tension, right? And, you know, it took, the first time we really had something that worked out, I think, was the mission statement of Partners in Health, which was, it was in 1987. And it's still a mission statement that I think folks are comfortable with now. And it borrows very heavily from, you'll probably be surprised, but Catholic social teaching. At least I was surprised, having PTSD from growing up Catholic. and, you know, it says it gets it right. You know, we'll make a preferential option for the poor in health care delivery. And it had two other parts of the mission. We're going to learn stuff while we're doing it, mm-hmm. and we're going to train others while we're being trained too.
Is that one of the primary differences between Partners in Health and other NGOs in terms of?
I think so. I think it's an academic NGO by design. Mm-hmm. I mean, that means, for example, if you're in Haiti, the teaching hospitals of Haiti are devastated or destroyed in a single day, as they were in January 2010. A group like Partners in Health should be saying, okay, we'll build a university hospital. Mm-hmm. That's what a teaching hospital is, a university hospital. And you know, I get why people said, well, how are you going to build a teaching hospital here, a a university hospital here, there's no university. And we said, yeah, yet. I mean, Gary Gottlieb, who's the director of Partners in Health, has pointed out many times that the growth of Boston is due to things like teaching hospitals. Yep. And, you know, that's, and cultivation of young talent.
So why don't we talk a bit about Ebola, because I think that's something that's, I mean, 2010 wasn't that long ago, but the Ebola epidemic was something that was very, very recent. How did Partners in Health react to that? And what exactly, how did you mobilize when the crisis hit? Did you basically go in force back in with a full staff?
Or we didn't have an office. We didn't have a single person. We didn't have a bank account. But those kind of challenges are quite familiar to us. You know, how do you organize staff, stuff, space, and systems? I'm not saying that we're have the logistic, and I will say we did not have the logistic capacity or the funding capacity of a Doctors Without Borders or another formal humanitarian disaster relief organization, none of those things. But starting from scratch is familiar to anyone who's worked in the medical desert in a rural area, because there's no electricity, no water. And here in this part of the world, that was true in the cities as well. So it takes time to organize that. And first, obviously, you can't impose your will on your colleagues, especially when it involves a dangerous moment, as it did there. In any case, I'm very proud of my coworkers from Partners in Health who decided that it was worth taking extra risks, since, again, the West Africans were already obliged to do that. It was either stay and help in whatever place you could or flee. And the ones who fled, I get it, you know. But we made the first choice to, you know, to stay and work, to start work with them. It was tough.
One of the first epidemics, obviously, I think you all took on was HIV, and led some of the most critical thinking about how to attack that epidemic. Can you talk a bit about where you think that stands today, and, you know, how do you think we've done as a global health community in terms of addressing that horrible disease?
Well, Americans should feel pretty proud of our record on that score, and that's really thanks to George Bush, because, and I've said it before, I'm not keen to say it right in front of him, but he knows. I mean, I would not have imagined that would be the most likely
legacy.
And also the most likely ally, you know, over the course of the epidemic started and, you know, it was recognized in 1981. And here we are in 2003. And the biggest commitment to a global health endeavor outside of this country, and we need to return to this country, that was the president's emergency plan for AIDS relief, George W. Bush's signature initiative. And in fact, I think a lot of us did think that would be his greatest legacy. And it is. And that's 15 million people who are alive today because of that. And that's not counting all the millions of new infections averted. And just to make that vivid, when I was in medical school, AIDS was the leading infectious killer of young adults in the United States, and just about anywhere, certainly in Southern Africa and Haiti. And there were lots of kids born with HIV. And it made sense, if you trained in the decade I did, to believe that it would be that way. But that's not what happened. That's because of treatment, which is also prevention, which prevents mother-to-child transmission. And again, back to PEPFAR, and there are others too. I'm just signaling PEPFAR as an American citizen. In the three districts that we work in Rwanda as Partners in Health with the Rwandan health authorities, I don't think there has been a single case of mother-to-child transmission in years.
Even in Rwanda?
In Rwanda. In fact, their record's better than ours in the United States. Again, because there are things you could learn in Haiti that you could take to Rwanda and take to... We need some of those things here in the United States. Our record in the United States, especially among people of color, is not as good as Rwanda's. And it's because we don't have a community-based system, right? We don't have community health workers. You have to beg for them to be funded or stipended. It's not, you know, it's dismissed as not sustainable, not feasible, a long set of very uncreative critiques from, you know, I would say health economists, but I can't imagine anybody who's really an economist buys it. But we don't have a good way of addressing chronic diseases in the United States. We have again, I'm quoting Gary, we have a illness care system, not a healthcare system, and you need both those to be integrated.
And you think other countries have more of a wellness culture to them?
Well, I mean, I'm going to speak about systems because I can't, even though I have a PhD in anthropology, I can't talk about culture. Maybe because of that, you know, I get, so what's culture and what's systems? Mm-hmm. So they have a very systems approach. And just as a metric, some of the metrics we have to look at how good an AIDS treatment program, for AIDS prevention, I said already, see how many kids are born with HIV. See how many women who are pregnant and could benefit from that life-saving therapy and disease-averting therapy, right? How many of them get enrolled, you know? And the numbers are good for Rwanda. What's really interesting, though, is when you look at who has, and forgive one little bit of jargon, if you take these medications, it's not curative, as everybody here knows, it suppresses the virus. So looking at viral suppression a year into therapy, in comparing American cities to Rwanda, even very rural areas, Rwanda has better numbers, right? Because too many people in the United States are lost to follow-up. Mm-hmm. And yes, you hear they have addiction, you hear they have housing instability, but I mean, 60% of the people where we lived in Rwanda were refugees, you know? They had housing instability because of the genocide. So we need to learn some of these things from Rwanda, and very proud to have been involved in those years.
Thank you very much for joining us today. It's been a great honor to have you here.
I feel the same way. Thank you.